Hello there, we continue taking a look at the pattern effects in Inkscape. This is part 2, where we'll see how to use all the patterns in the second category, distortion. These effects are in my opinion much more useful overall, since they are oriented to distorting already made objects. All of them work with groups, not just individual paths, which makes them even more flexible. But before continuing, I make Inkscape and illustration videos every week, so if you're interested, make sure to subscribe and hit the bell. And don't forget to like and comment. It really helps the channel grow. Bend will allow you to use a path to bend another path. It has a huge amount of possible uses. It's super easy to use, and I think it's one of the most essential path effects to learn. You apply it to the object you want to bend. The effect will automatically apply a path you can use to change the shape. You need to click on this button to be able to edit it on the canvas. This is a normal straight line path, meaning you can modify it with the node tool as with any other path. You can change the shape, add and remove nodes, change the node type, etc. The effect also gives you an extra control to change the overall width with this diamond. But you'll notice that this automatic path is always placed horizontally, even if the object is set vertically. In that case, you could rotate the object horizontally and then apply the effect, or use this button to do this automatically for you. Most of the time, a single straight line path is enough to do the basic bend operations, but if you want, you can use your own custom path. Just copy the path you want to use, go to the path effect options, and hit this button. You still have the control to change its width if you want. You can also use the bend effect with closed paths, and you still have control over it as if it was a normal path. One very important thing to keep in mind is that all effects in the distort category work with groups, and this is where it allows you to do some really amazing things with finished illustrations, like applying some bend to this completed tree. Pattern along path is used to repeat a path along another path, like custom dashes, but with paths instead. This is another super important effect to know how it works. This one works a bit differently than the previous one. Unlike with the bend effect, you apply it to the path you want the repeated path to go along. This time you must apply your own path, just like before, copy the path you want and then click on this button to paste it. By default it will show like this, due to an option in the set effects. You can change that with the drop-down pattern copies. Repeated will just repeat the pattern all along the path. Repeated stretched will adjust the path so it fits nicely all the way through by stretching if needed. These two options are most likely what you want. But then you have single, we'll just put a single copy, kinda useless option, and single stretched, the default option, it just stretches one path along, it's useless. If you want to bend a path, you have much more flexibility using the bend effect. You can still edit the path normally, moving the nodes with the node tool and adding and removing nodes, it all works. You also have the same width control from the bend effect to control the width. The interesting part is that you can change and modify the copied path, and that will reflect on the other one in real time. This way you have a lot of control over the way it looks. But also notice that the fill and stroke properties are not passed down to the other object. These properties are still changed by selecting the other path and changing them. There are a couple of important options in the path effect dialog that you want to know to refine the way it looks. The spacing input will change how much spacing there is between copies. The normal offset will change the up and down of the copies. And pattern is vertical will flip the copies. Here is a quick tip that's helpful for this effect that obscures the path under. You can click on this option in the tool controls of the node tool to show the outline of the path. This way you can see where it is located behind all these shapes. One thing to notice here that is super important, sadly this effect does not allow you to use group objects as patterns, only single paths. As you can see here, it only copied the moon shape, not all the other ones. This is weird because it makes complete sense that you may want to repeat more complicated illustrations along a path. Transform by 2 points is a bit of a helper tool to make scaling and rotating easier, most useful for technical illustrations that require accurate transformations. Once that you apply this effect, when you switch to the node tool, you should see this new control line with two diamonds. One is the first node and the other one is the last node. By moving any of these, you will be able to control the scale and rotation, pivoting from the opposite node. You can lock the length with this button and it will allow you to rotate the object using the last node without the scaling. You can even have a nice helper icon to let you know from where you should rotate. You can also lock the angle to scale along the angle of the line. Flip vertical and horizontal will flip the object vertically and horizontally along the line. Elastic will disable the uniform scaling that's enabled by default. You probably noticed that this effect will place the line between two nodes in your path. You can change this with the first node and last node input boxes to switch between different nodes' positions. Incredibly awkward way to control the position of the line. It would have been much better to be able to draw the lines ourselves. Anyway, you can also use the button from original width to place the line in the center of the path. A little note, you can use this effect with groups, but in that case you won't have the option to switch the line position between nodes. It's automatically placed in the center. The other options that are useful are stretch, which will scale the object perpendicular to the line, and offset, which will offset the object perpendicularly to the line. Envelope deformation will let you deform a path along its borders by using four other paths. This effect is nice to make some large-scale subtle adjustments to a finished illustration, though there are other distort effects that may be better. After it's applied, you have to click on the first button of each row to show a line path that covers the top, right, bottom and left area of the bounding box of the path. Just like with the other distort effects, this path is just a normal path that you can modify with the node tool, and do everything you could with any other normal path, including adding and removing nodes and changing its type. Any change you do will influence the area where it's located, so the way the object looks is a combination of the influence made by the shape of these four paths. And similar to the other distort effects, you can use your own custom path instead of the simple line path the FX brings by default. Like before, just copy the path you want. You may want to place this path closer to where it should be. Then you click on this last button on the right row. The perspective envelope is one of the most useful path effects in Inkscape. It's one of my favorite because it's so powerful and easy to use, and I think it's essential to learn. You can use it to draw objects flat and then put them in perspective, or also use it as a better and easier to use version of the previous effect we saw. Using it is super simple. When you switch to the node tool, you'll see four control points at the corners. Moving these points distorts the object as if it were positioned in perspective, so all you have to do is to make it match. This tool is great together with an axonometric grid. I have a tutorial on that, make sure to check out the description. In the type dropdown, you have the option to switch to envelope deformation. And now it works similarly to the way the previous effect worked with the default paths, only that you cannot bend them. I much prefer this way to make larger scale deformations, even if you don't have the option to bend them. Mostly because it's much easier and intuitive, and most of the time it's completely unnecessary to bend anything. These two options to mirror horizontally and vertically can be quite useful. Very important, don't forget this effect works with groups. That means that you can draw entirely using multiple paths, flat, and then put them in perspective using this effect. It's a great way to work in 3D in Inkscape. Lattice deformation creates a lattice of 5 control points by 5. By moving the points, you affect the area closer to that point. I kinda hate this effect. A deformation lattice, especially one that works with groups, like this one, seems really, really useful. But that's until you realize that you cannot change the amount of points the lattice have. 5x5, it's always either too much or too little points to be that helpful. There really isn't that much to this effect. You can only change the position of the points. There is no path to curve. There's also the option to mirror the movement horizontally and vertically. and you cannot reposition the nodes to specific parts of the illustration. It's always an equal size grid. Like I said, I don't think this effect is that helpful, though I guess to make some more organic shapes it can work out. It's just annoying to see the wasted potential, because being able to have a lattice that you can change the amount of points could be extremely useful, and I cannot think of a reason why the developers did not implement that into this effect. Roughen do one thing, and it does it pretty good. It just roughens the silhouette of the shape, something that will be a pain to do manually. You have no control points or anything like it. Everything is managed through the options in the path effect dialog. Global randomize is how strong is the displacement, that is, how much the bumpy silhouette pushes out. Then you have controls exclusively for the horizontal and vertical strength, not that important in my opinion, but useful if you're going for a particular look. And then is the segment size option. Here you control how big are the bumps. There are more settings, but those are the really important ones. You can safely skip everything else. One final warning. This effect, like all the distort effects, works with groups, but you may want to be careful because the effect is applied to all objects individually. So if you have overlapping objects that share a border, like shadows or highlights, then it may break the design. And we are done with all path effects in the distort category. Next video we'll continue with the generate category. Don't forget to like and subscribe for more videos on Inkscape and illustration, and let me know what you think about the video in the comments below. That's it for now, bye!